Jimmy had no formal training in art at all, actually, other than his period as an apprentice. Yeah, one of the earlier periods that my father's art went through was the jazz period. Early years in the United States. He felt that it was somehow intrinsically American. And so a lot of his work tended to revolve, in those early years, revolve around the imagery, the rhythmic quality that comes out of jazz. One of the first jobs that he actually had in the United States that was directly related to art was doing the covers for a lot of the jazz albums that were released back then.
I'm Phyllis Braff. I'm an art historian and art critic. I've known the work of Jimmy Ernst for decades. One of his strongest features is the visionary quality that one finds in his work. In this work from 1942, there are strong references to biomorphic forms, which is another avenue into the subconscious. There's also a use of white that gives us an otherworldly quality, besides strong highlights in the work. There's also a use of line that occurs in certain areas of this work that begins to impose a rhythmic structure in a way that was pioneering and puts Jimmy Ernst in the position of something of a precursor for work that was to come later.
In most of my father's work, there was more of a sense of discretion about the nightmares that haunted him. In his early works, he was less inclined to. This painting here is it's entitled The Elements, and it's actually quite symptomatic of the earliest work that my father...
early 1940s.
It's 1942. This is entitled Totem from 1953, yeah. By title and content related to American Indian totems. As the title implies, and ties in with the work that he did later, the Kachina painting that he completed just prior to his death. This painting is entitled Animal and Mineral from 1952, and it's something of a transitional painting from his the earlier almost surrealist images with floating shapes, and then into his jazz period with hints of rhythms and tensions going on within the canvas, to the more linear things that he did in the late 50s and early 60s.
Ernst worked with line, which had been just a thread in the work of the surrealists, a thread that would be a vehicle for the automatic expression of the subconscious. He took the line and made it into something controlled and organized, and this opened up a great many horizons for expressive possibilities in art. He imposed a rhythm and a kind of order that seems quite impressive and important. In a work like this from the mid-60s, he also introduced a figurative element that made one think there are several levels of perception operating at the same time, and he further developed that with his use of color. The web in Jimmy Ernst's work became more and more important and linked all edges of the surface together. In this sense, he anticipated many of the developments that were to occur in art of the late 60s and 70s. The grid in Jimmy Ernst's work holds the eye on the surface and helps to develop several layers of expressive color and form. There's also a very strong sense of rhythm. One also feels the quality of mystical light informing the works, the kind of light that he had running through his work from the earliest decades.
This painting is entitled Cochino. It was from 1982. It was one of the final paintings from the last series of paintings my father did, which the last few years of his life, as he was writing his autobiography, he wasn't overly prolific.
The legacy that my father leaves is a very powerful and it's very broad.
I think that his importance to me and
other young artists, as well as to all of his peers, lay in his relationship to painting as a rather exalted profession. The quote that's on his gravestone actually is that artists and poets are the raw nerve ends of society, that by themselves there's very little that they can do to save humanity, but without them there would be very, very little left worth saving.
Thank you.